This morning, as we prepare ourselves for worship after hearing the beautiful gift of music, I think it seems appropriate to remember the more than 500 million souls that have been lost to the United States due to COVID, let alone the 2.5 million around the world. So if you will just pray with me. God of hope and healing, God of love and everlasting life, we grieve the loss of more than 500 million lives, the loss of their gifts, the loss of their joy, the loss of their love. We pray for their families and their friends as they mourn their beloved. And we pray for the other 2 million around the world who are sharing in that grief. Help us not to remember, not to forget them, not to become numb to this great loss. Knowing still that you give new life through death, that they are now with you in resurrection, and that we will meet them again in eternal life. We pray for hope and healing for all those who are still struggling with COVID, the aftermath of COVID, and for all the medical professionals and researchers and everyone who is trying to get the vaccine to everyone. May it be swift and work well so that we can return to a time when we were able to hug each other, when we're able to be together in worship. But never let us forget what we missed so that we will appreciate those gifts once we return to what we have become accustomed to in the past. Bless us with awareness and compassion and holy love in Jesus' name. Amen. We now begin our worship service. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
During the season of Lent, we are called to return to the Lord with all that we are, body, mind, and spirit. Let us now take a moment of silence to examine our hearts and confess our sins as we seek to reconcile with God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned
against you
in thought, word,
and deed,
by what
we have done
and by what
we have left undone.
We have not loved you
with our whole heart.
We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves.
For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ,
have mercy
on us.
forgive us, renew us,
and lead us,
so that we may
make light in your walk,
your will,
and walk in your ways,
to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the name of our merciful God, and as a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, I declare to you with his authority that your sins are forgiven. Accept God's mercy. Come to know God's grace.
Amen.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, through the passion of Christ Jesus, you took an instrument of a shameful death and made it the means of life for us. Grant us
glory in the cross,
that we may
honor Jesus' gift
of love,
by living our lives fully and faithfully
in his holy name.
Amen.
Our reading this morning is from Psalm 22. You who fear the Lord, give praise. All you of Jacob's line, give glory. Stand in awe of the Lord, all you offspring of Israel. For the Lord does not despise nor abhor the poor in their poverty. Neither is the Lord's face hidden from them. But when they cry out, the Lord hears them. From you comes my praise in the great assembly. I will perform my vows in the sight of those who fear the Lord. The poor shall eat and be satisfied. Let those who seek the Lord give praise. May your hearts live forever. And our gospel this morning is from Mark, the 8th chapter. Jesus began to teach the disciples that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all of this quite openly. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." The Gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Please pray with me. Holy and eternal God, as we listen to your message and hear your words, may they touch our minds and change our hearts. In Jesus' holy name, amen. So I imagine you probably all heard the saying, "The devil's in the details." The devil's in the details. So that's been my excuse for not being a very detail-oriented person. I much rather focus on the big picture, the vision, and let others who are more adept at worrying about the details worry about them. Most of the time, that works fine. Most of the time. I think the Apostle Peter may have been a big picture guy. Not only was he the leader of the apostles, but he was also the first to recognize Jesus as the Messiah, the Savior. Peter saw the big picture, at least his version of it. He believed soon everyone would know that Jesus was the Messiah, that Jesus had come to save Israel and would be their king. And then, finally, Roman persecution would be over. Life, as they say, was good. Sadly, though, Peter only got to savor that feeling for just but a moment, because what Jesus said next shocked him back to reality. As our story continued, Jesus told the disciples for the very first time what was going to happen, that he was going to endure great suffering, that he would be rejected by the elders and the chief priests, and that he would be humiliated and killed, and after 3 days, rise again. Can you imagine Peter's shock? In one moment, he's making this amazing confession of faith, proclaiming Jesus to be the Messiah come to save Israel. How amazing that must have felt to see the realization of all that you've been taught, all that you have believed and hoped for, come true. But then the very next moment, Jesus says he's going to die. Peter's head must have been ready to explode. And his heart. How could this be? Well, that's just it. For Peter, it couldn't be. Everything Peter had learned since childhood, his entire Jewish faith, hinged on the coming of the Messiah to save Israel. And everything he'd seen while he was with Jesus, everything he'd learned, the miracles, the feeding of the 5,000, the walking on water, healing the lepers, the blind, the deaf, told him Jesus was the Messiah. Every bone in Peter's body told him what Jesus was saying now must be wrong. How could he save Israel if he died? So Peter told Jesus that he must be mistaken. Jesus must not die. It couldn't happen. Peter wouldn't let it. Peter didn't get the reaction that he had hoped for. Instead, he and the disciples got another shock, because Jesus didn't stop to explain what he meant, help them understand his words as he had done so many times before, as they had come to expect from Jesus. No, this time his reaction was very different. Jesus addressed Peter, but he looked at all of the disciples and he said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." The problem with being a big picture person is that often the devil is in the details. Remember last week's message when we talked about Satan tempting Jesus in the desert? And at the end, we heard that when the devil had completed every temptation, he departed from Jesus until a more opportune time. Well, my friends, this was one of those more opportune times. It's not that Jesus was saying Peter was Satan, but Jesus knew Satan was trying to tempt him through Peter's well-intentioned words. Satan tempted Jesus in the desert by offering food and power. In Peter's understandable confusion, he was tempting Jesus to be an earthly Messiah of power, rather than the heavenly Messiah who came to serve and to die for the sake of humanity, for the sake of all creation. Peter's confusion wasn't his fault. He only knew what he'd been taught. He was expecting a powerful Messiah, a king, and he had figured Jesus was just waiting until the time was right. But a suffering Messiah was not what Peter expected, was not what he had prayed for, was not what he had hoped for. Nothing prepared Peter or the disciples for this. They were devastated and confused. We also have times when the God we meet is not the God we prayed for, not the God we expected, not the God we'd hoped for. And when God's plan confuses us, our faith may suffer. We may wonder if God truly is a God of mercy and love. And if so, then why aren't our needs being fulfilled? Why aren't our prayers being answered? Hopefully, as time goes on, we come to understand God's plan. But in the meantime, we gather to worship, even if over Zoom. We gather to be strengthened by God's word, to be nurtured at the table, to be surrounded by the support of our faith community, our church family, until our faith and our hope are restored. I once heard pastor and professor David Lowe say, "Church isn't the place you go to when you have it all together. It's the place you run to when life is falling apart." Just think of if in just think if in his time of confusion and doubt, Peter decided to leave his faith community. If he decided to go away and he left Jesus and the disciples in his despair, where would that have left him? Where would that have left his faith? He would have been alone, lost, and confused, rather than called, fulfilled, and inspired. And that reminds me of those frustrating details. There's an important detail that in Peter's shock and confusion, he totally missed. The most important detail, because Jesus didn't just tell the disciples that he was going to suffer and die. He also told them that he would rise again in 3 days. You are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things. Therein lies the problem. Peter was so focused on human things, on the suffering and death of Jesus, that he totally missed the divine thing Jesus shared. This wasn't only the first time Jesus told his disciples about his death. It was also the first time Jesus told them about his resurrection. Jesus was telling the disciples, better than that, he was promising the disciples that he would come again, not only to save Israel, but save the entire world. Yes, his death would be hard and it would be sad, but it wasn't the end. It was a new beginning. Out of death comes new life. Today's gospel is a turning point for Jesus as he prepares for the difficult journey ahead to the cross. It is also a turning point in the disciples' journey as they are called to a new understanding of God's plan and their part in it. And today's gospel and Jesus calls us to do the same thing. To ask ourselves as disciples of Christ, as beloved children of God, is this a turning point in my life as a disciple of Jesus? And it doesn't stop there, because we are called to answer that same question as a faith community. Is this a turning point for the people of St. Paul's? Does God have a new plan for you in this place and in this time? If so, will you allow yourselves to be shaped by this turning point? Turning points can be scary, but they can also be wonderful. Take a moment to ask yourself what turning points you've known in your life when everything changed. But when you look back, you now realize that your life was shaped in a new and wonderful way by that turning point. St. Paul's friends, as we continue to pray for an answer to where God is leading you for your future as a congregation, a new call for St. Paul's. It may feel a bit overwhelming. It may also feel like something precious is ending. And yet there's also the possibility of an exciting new beginning, new life in this place. Our faith tells us that we just need to trust in the promise of our life-giving God. The promise that out of death comes resurrection. And there's no devil in that detail. Thanks be to God. For our time of reflection, I would like you to take some time to think about a turning point in your life that was hard. But then as time passed, you ended up seeing gifts in it, gifts from God. You now realize that your life was shaped in a new way, a new beginning because of what happened. If we were together, I'd ask you to share with each other, which I know drives Lutherans crazy, but we can't do that exactly. But take a moment for yourself and pray about that. Amen. Together now with Christians around the world, we confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified,
died, and was buried.
He descended
to the dead.
On the third day, he rose again.
He ascended to heaven.
He is seated
at the right hand of the Father.
And he will come
to judge the living and the dead.
I believe
in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church,
the communion
of saints,
the forgiveness
of sins, the resurrection of the body,
and the life
everlasting. Amen.
In our prayers this morning to the petition, Hear Us, O God, please respond, Your mercy is great. Relying on the promises of our merciful God, we pray boldly for the church, the world, and all in need. Your gift of grace is for all people. Give confident faith to all your people that they may follow you wholeheartedly. Give new believers joy and hope in your promises, and give courage to those who suffer in their faith. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
All the ends of the earth worship you, from galaxies to microorganisms, from the largest to the tiniest of your creatures, preserve all creation. Teach humanity to wonder at your works and love the beauty that surrounds us. Inspire us to join you in tending to creation's well-being. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You rule over the nations. Raise up advocates for peace and justice within and between nations. Direct the words and actions of our president, vice president, and all elected leaders in our community, country, and world, that they may work for the good of all people and creation. Give life where hope seems dead. Call into existence new realities we cannot even imagine. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy
is great.
Even in the wilderness, you are with us. Tend to those whose lives feel dry and desolate. We grieve the loss of over 2.5 million lives due to the coronavirus, more than 500,000 lives in our country alone. We pray the vaccine is soon available to all at risk. We pray for those suffering from terminal disease or chronic pain, those who struggle with mental health disease or addictions, and those who are neglected or abused, and for all who cry out to you. We lift up those close to the heart of our St. Paul's family. Today we pray for Alan, Alex, Annie, Barbara, Bob, Bonnie, Brian, Ed, Eunice, Phil, Gloria, Janet, Jerry, Joan, Catherine, Ken, Kim, Kimberly, Larry, Lori, Leslie, Lillian, Lorianne, Louise, Lydia, Lynn, Mary, Marianne, Monica, Richard, Rob, Rosa, Rosemary, Roy, Stephanie, Trent, and Yuko. And a prayer this morning for those who are grieving. Holy God, we pray for the family of Jim Harlan, who, after fighting a long battle with cancer, passed away surrounded by the love of his family. We especially pray for his wife, Allison, the niece of Louise Stetzner and Winnie Sorin, and for Jim and Allison's children. Surround them with your strength as they grieve the loss of their loved one. Give them comfort in their memories and hope in your promises. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Nurture our St. Paul's congregation in our baptismal identity and teach us to live our promises out fully and faithfully for the sake of the church and the world. Strengthen our congregation's social ministry and social justice. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We await the day of Christ's coming in glory. Lead us by the example of all the saints whom you have called to focus on divine things, that together we may find our lives in you. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We entrust ourselves and all our prayers to you, O faithful God, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Faithful God, you walk beside us in our desert places.
We offer our gifts to you. Show us how to use them for the building of our faith community and for the work you call us in the world.
Amen.
We lift our bread together. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, Jesus took the cup and gave thanks. He gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Let us pray in the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come.
Thy will be done on earth
as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not
into temptation,
but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power,
and the glory.
Forever and ever.
Amen.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, together we are fed. Receive holy nourishment for your journey. The body and blood of Christ given for you.
Amen.
Oh,
You may have read, if you read your epistle, that we now have our transition team set up. And while it's smaller than normal because of COVID, I am delighted that Carol Bruce and Joy Hansen have agreed to serve with me as part of the transition team. Keep them in your prayers as they do the work they're being called to do and as they put up with my many demands. This morning, we will commission them for this service. Friends in Christ, it is our privilege to recognize and support those who are engaged in the faithful work of this St. Paul's congregation. Today, we recognize those who have been called to serve as part of the transition team. Carol and Joy, will you strive to use your God-given gifts and pattern your life on Christ, giving thanks to God and opening your hearts and minds to God's call as you carry out your ministry to this congregation?
I will.
And I ask God
to help me.
People of God, I ask you, will you support your sisters in Christ in their service and share in the mutual ministry that Christ has given to all who are called to serve?
We will.
And we ask God to help us.
Let us pray. God of grace, your Holy Spirit equips the church with a rich variety of gifts. Bless these disciples who have answered your call to serve as leaders in your church. Give them open minds, listening ears, caring hearts, and wise counsel. And bless this St. Paul's congregation as they discern where you are leading them in for mission for the sake of the world. Strengthen their faith and help them to discern their purpose in fulfilling your mission. Holy God, inspire us all to answer your call. As we are sent into the world, help us to use our gifts to bear witness to Christ in all that we say and do, so that the lives we touch may come to know your grace and love.
Amen.
So normally I would ask for applause, so we'll just do Zoom applause. Thank you, Joy, and thank you, Carol, both for agreeing to be part of this team. I'm looking forward to serving with you both, beginning with the history event. Friends in Christ, you are what God made you to be, chosen as holy and beloved, called to serve your neighbor. May God bless you, that you may be a blessing. Amen.
Amen.
Go in peace. Remember the poor.
Thanks be to God.
Before we get into the Holy History event, I just have a few announcements. This week, if you haven't signed up for one of the small group sessions yet, this week is your last opportunity. Pastor will be meeting with several of our young adults tomorrow night at 7 o'clock to talk to them about what St. Paul's means to them, etc. And then Tuesday, the last two opportunities for the rest of us, 11 a.m. tomorrow morning, Tuesday morning, and 7 p.m. Tuesday evening. So if you haven't attended one of the small group sessions, these are your last opportunities. And then on Wednesday, we have our midweek Lenten service. We're doing things a little bit differently this year. It's basically, and Pastor, correct me if I'm misspeaking, but we're basically using it as a time of Lenten devotion and discussion, more or less. We're following a book by Max Lucado called Unshakable Hope. Looks like this. if you would, you don't need to buy the book. If you would like to get the excerpts that we'll be looking at ahead of time, you can get in touch with either Pastor or Jerry Valancourt, and they'll make sure you have the information. Otherwise, as I said, you don't have to read it ahead of time. Somebody will read the pertinent sections, and then we'll just have some discussion about it. So please consider joining us. Last week's was a really good discussion, I thought. And the more people we get, the more inspiring I think the discussions will become. And then last but not least, just to let everybody know, the reopening committee did meet last week, and will be meeting again next week to hopefully finalize a proposal to the council, with a plan for reopening for in-person worship. So we're working on it. Stay tuned. Hopefully shortly after the council meeting, in the middle of March, we'll be able to let you in on some plans.